morning. I love Christmas time. If anything, just for the music, it's. I'm sure we could sing those songs throughout the year, but there's something about singing "Hark the Herald Angels Sing" at Christmas time. So, I invite you to turn in your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 11. Isaiah chapter 11. We're continuing in our Advent sermon series, the promises of Advent, looking back at the promises of God foretold by the prophets and fulfilled in Christ's first coming and yet to be fully realized at his second coming. This morning we are focusing on the Advent theme of peace. Last week was hope. This week is peace. And it's fitting that we look at these Advent themes. We live in a world that desperately longs for peace, but often struggles to find it. We see examples of this in the ongoing wars in the Middle East and in Ukraine. We see it in political divides that keep growing deeper with every election. We see it in broken families and strained relationships. We see it in rising mental health struggles like anxiety and depression. And we shouldn't be surprised at the lack of peace in our world. After all, Jesus said that in the last days, nations will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines and earthquakes in various places, and all these are about the beginning of the birth pains. Matthew 24, verses 7 to 8. So this is just the beginning, and it'll just keep on increasing. But in our heart of hearts, we long for peace. We long for something steady and secure amidst the turbulence of life. Well, this longing for peace isn't new. The people in Isaiah's day lived in a period of deep unrest, political instability, social corruption, spiritual decay, that sort of thing. But God promised that a ruler from King David's line would come and bring peace, unlike anything the world has ever seen. And into a world starved for peace, Jesus comes as the Prince of Peace, offering us reconciliation with God, harmony with one another, and the hope of a restored creation. So follow along with me as I read for us Isaiah 11, verses 1 to 10. There shall come forth a shoot from the stump of Jesse, and a branch from his roots shall bear fruit. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. And his delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see, or decide disputes by what his ears hear. But with righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. And he shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt of his waist, and faithfulness the belt of his loins. The wolf shall dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the young goat, and the calf and the lion and the fattened calf together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, their young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the cobra, and the weaned child shall put his hand on the adder's den. They shall not hurt or destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. In that day, the root of Jesse, who shall stand as a signal for the peoples, Of him shall the nations inquire, and his resting place shall be glorious. May God bless the reading of his word. Back in Isaiah chapter 6, just to give the context for what Isaiah says here in Isaiah 11. Back in Isaiah 6, Isaiah saw a forest that was cut down and burned. It's a picture of what was coming for the people of God for failing to trust in the Lord. It would be like burned out stumps, field of burned out stumps. But God would not leave his people in ruin and devastation. No, he promises to preserve a remnant, a stump out of which would come a shoot of life. And we see that in Isaiah 6, verse 13. This forestry imagery then continues on in Isaiah 10, where the nation of Assyria, you remember them from last week, they are pictured as a mighty forest. And Assyria would be the nation that would conquer the northern kingdom of Israel in 722 BC. And they would loom as a threat over the southern kingdom of Judah. But in Isaiah chapter 10, verses 33 to 34, God declares judgment on Assyria. It says, "Behold, the Lord God of hosts will lop the boughs with terrifying power. The great in height will be hewn down, and the lofty will be brought low. He will cut down the thickets of the forest with an axe, and Lebanon will fall by the majestic one." Now, it's interesting because in Isaiah 10, verse 15, Assyria was the axe that God used to cut down the forest of his people's pride. But just like the people of God, the Assyrians also had become arrogant. And so God cuts them down with his mighty axe of grace. And when God swings his axe, he doesn't just lop off the tops. No, he goes down to the stump. And it's in this field of burned out stumps that this little shoot of life appears. Look with me at Isaiah 11, verse 1. "There shall come forth a shoot from the stump of Jesse, and a branch from his roots shall bear fruit." Although the tree of David's line had been cut down and burned, so to speak, there was still life in the root. A descendant of David would come to bring life and light to all people. Back in 2 Samuel chapter 7, verses 12 to 13, God promised King David, "When your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever." So David knew that this would one day be fulfilled. But this wouldn't just be any descendant of David. After all, there would be several bad kings that would come from David's line. No, this descendant of David would have the anointing of the Holy Spirit. That's what we see in verse 2. "The Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord." We also see the Spirit being given to this descendant of David elsewhere in Isaiah. In Isaiah 42, verse 1, we read, "Behold, my servant, whom I uphold, my chosen, in whom my soul delights, I have put my Spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the nations." And also in Isaiah 61, verses 1 to 2, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to those who are bound, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God." One commentator writes, He has the spirit of wisdom and understanding for leadership, the spirit of counsel and might for war, and the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord for holiness. The problem with many of the kings of Judah and all of the kings of Israel, and we could probably say the same for many of the political leaders in our day and age, is that they did not rule with a desire to obey and please the Lord. Instead, they were concerned about maintaining their own power. But this ruler would be different. Verse 3 says, his delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. But then, unlike earthly leaders who are swayed by appearances, this ruler also will not judge by what his eyes see or decide disputes by what his ears hear. He will not be biased in favor of the rich and powerful, like so many leaders in our day and age. Instead, he will concern himself with what is right, according to the standards of the righteous one. As a result, the poor and the meek will no longer be at a disadvantage with the rich. And if the powerful are among the wicked, they will not escape his judgment. His words will be more powerful than the mightiest rod that some other kings might use to enforce their will. And the breath of his lips will not only pronounce the sentence of judgment on the wicked, but it will actually kill them. How will all of this be possible? Verse 5, righteousness shall be the belt of his waist and faithfulness the belt of his loins. Our English translations tend to obscure the imagery in this verse. What we're seeing here is a reference to this ruler's most intimate garments. You know, when everything is stripped away, what we find left is a continual concern for what is right and what is true. And the result of this ruler's leadership will be peace. But peace isn't just the absence of war or conflict. That's what we tend to think of peace. You know, we tend to think of a ceasefire, as it were. But that's not what the Bible speaks of when it speaks of peace. When the Bible speaks of peace, shalom, it's talking about wholeness. It's talking about completeness. You know, it's what happens when every aspect of life, the spiritual, the physical, the relational, the societal, when all of that is aligned with the will of God, when everything is as it should be, that is true peace. What we read next sounds something like from the Disney movie Zootopia, you know, where you've got predator and prey living together in harmony. Look at verses 6 to 8. The wolf shall dwell with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the young goat, and the calf and the lion and the fattened calf together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, their young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the cobra, and the weaned child shall put his hand in the adder's den. You know, could such a world really exist? And the answer is yes. Isaiah 65, verse 25, says that in the new heavens and the new earth, the wolf and the lamb shall graze together. The lion shall eat straw like the ox, and dust shall be the serpent's food. This seems like a far cry from where the world is today. As Romans 8, verse 22 says, the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. We feel that. But Isaiah envisions a day when creation will be free from the curse of sin and death, where all creatures will live in harmony. But then this restoration reaches beyond the animal kingdom to us. Again, carrying on with Romans 8. In Romans 8, verse 23, it says that not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, we groan inwardly as we eagerly wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. Right? We need the dramatic change that Isaiah is speaking about. And we see it here in verse 9. They shall not hurt or destroy in all my holy mountain. For the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. There is coming a day when the people of God will experience creation as it was always intended to be experienced, but couldn't be experienced because of sin. You know, humanity has long pursued various utopias in an effort to achieve peace, yet all of them fall short of the perfect harmony that is described in these verses. You know, we think of political utopias like the Roman Empire's Pax Romana, Roman peace, or even Marxism. They've sought stability, but they often rely on flawed human power and justice. Philosophical movements like the Enlightenment aim for progress, but they fail to address the moral and spiritual brokenness of humanity. Religious utopias like theonomy or the New Age movement frequently devolve into legalism and shallow self-focus. Then there's scientific and technological advances, like the Industrial Revolution and artificial intelligence that promise solutions, but obviously cannot resolve sin's effects on human relationships and creation. There's the cultural movements, like the hippie counterculture and globalization efforts, that have noble ideals, but that falter under human selfishness and conflict. Now, when we realize nothing seems to work, these attempts reveal the universal longing for shalom, a peace that we simply cannot bring about in our own power and ability. And so in verse 10, Isaiah reminds us that the only way that any of this is possible is through this Spirit-empowered ruler, who is from the root of Jesse. It is he who shall stand as a signal for the people. It is he of whom the nations shall inquire. It is he whose resting place shall be glorious. The one who made the world will see to it that it is transformed so that every square inch of the world will be the holy mountain of the Lord. And who is this shoot from the stump of Jesse, this Spirit-empowered ruler of God's people, this perfectly wise and perfectly just king who is bringing perfect peace on the earth? Who is he? Luke chapter 1, verses 31 to 33, we find out who he is. There the angel Gabriel says to Mary, "You will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." And so we see that Jesus Christ is the fulfillment of God's promises here in Isaiah chapter 11. Just as God promised that the Messiah would come as a shoot from the stump of Jesse, filled with the Spirit of the Lord and characterized by wisdom, understanding, counsel, might, and knowledge, and would have a fear of the Lord. So Jesus is the perfect descendant of David, fully empowered by the Holy Spirit, displaying divine wisdom and reverence for the Father. Just as God promised that the Messiah would reign with righteousness, judge with equity, and bring justice to the poor and the meek while defeating the wicked, so Jesus is the righteous King, whose ministry uplifted the downtrodden, confronted sin and corruption, and revealed God's justice. Just as God promised that the Messiah would bring peace to all of creation, where natural enemies would live in harmony, violence would cease, and the earth would be filled with the knowledge of the Lord, so Jesus demonstrated his authority over creation through miracles and by reconciling humanity and creation to God through his death on the cross and his resurrection from the dead. Just as God promised that the Messiah would stand as a banner for all nations, drawing people from every corner of the earth to himself and offering a glorious resting place, so Jesus is the Savior for all nations, inviting people from every tribe and tongue and nation into his kingdom through the gospel. So we see Jesus Christ is the fulfillment of God's promises here in Isaiah 11. Throughout history, leaders have made promises that have often been broken. Woodrow Wilson won re-election in 1916 with the slogan, he kept us out of the war, only to enter into World War I a year later. Herbert Hoover's pledge in 1928 to end poverty in America, famously promising to put a chicken in every pot and a car in every garage, this promise was broken within 1 year by the worst economic depression in recent history. Lyndon B. Johnson promised in 1964, we are not about to send American boys 9,000 to 10,000 miles away from home to do what Asian boys ought to do for themselves. During his presidency, the U.S. entered the Vietnam War. George H.W. Bush famously promised in 1988, read my lips, no new taxes, only to sign a bill raising taxes during his first and only term in office. And then, of course, there's our current prime minister's running list of broken promises. I won't necessarily get into all of that. But in Isaiah chapter 11, we are reminded that God always keeps his promises. Now, the promises of God may not be fulfilled in the way we expect. After all, the Jews in Jesus' day were certain that the promise of a descendant of David meant a military leader who would rule over them and who would defeat their military enemies, the Romans. But in Jesus, we find a ruler we can trust, who governs not for personal gain, but for the good of his people, who would destroy not simply physical enemies, but our spiritual enemies of sin, death, the devil, and hell, and whose kingdom is the only way there will ever be peace on the earth. Now, in one sense, Christ's kingdom has already come. Right? Through his life, death, and resurrection, Jesus has brought spiritual peace and renewal to those who trust in him. But the fullness of his kingdom is still to come. All right, while Jesus reigns in the hearts of his followers, sin and injustice remain in the world. But at Christ's second coming, he will judge the wicked and vindicate the righteous. The idyllic picture of predator and prey dwelling together in harmony has not yet been fully realized, but in the new heavens and the new earth, creation will be fully restored and at peace. While the gospel has certainly reached many people, the world is not yet filled with the knowledge of the Lord, and many even reject him. But at Christ's second coming, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Until then, we live in the hope of what was already accomplished and in anticipation of what is still to come, knowing that God will keep his promises. The fullness of Christ's kingdom is really only an inch away. You know, all that stands between this present moment of unrest and the promised future of peace is the command of God. Right? All he has to do is give the order, and Christ will come and will judge and will save and will rule, because he himself is our peace. Ephesians 2 verse 14 says, we're that close to peace on earth and goodwill toward men. During World War I, fighting on the Western Front between the Germans and the Allies was fierce. Hope for a quick war was gone. Both armies knew that they would be bitter enemies for years. A system of trenches separated the two sides, with the area in between regarded as no man's land. But on Christmas Eve in 1914, an unofficial truce began. German soldiers began singing Silent Night in German. Men on the other side of the Great Divide joined along in English. Soldiers who hours before had been attempting to kill one another were now singing songs together about the wonder of Christ's birth. As the night and the singing continued, the soldiers emerged out of their trenches to join one another in no man's land, where they exchanged gifts, joined in burial services, and famously played soccer together. An estimated 100,000 soldiers along the Western Front laid down their weapons all that night and the next day. Now, in subsequent years, their commanders would demand that they continue fighting. But for a brief moment, there was peace on earth and goodwill toward men. We sang earlier the song, Silent Night, Holy Night. All is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin, mother and child, holy infant, so tender and mild. Sleep in heavenly peace. Sleep in heavenly peace. Silent Night, Holy Night, shepherds quake at the sight, glory stream from heaven afar. Heavenly hosts sing, Alleluia. Christ the Savior is born. Christ the Savior is born. Silent night, holy night. Son of God, love's pure light. Radiant beams from thy holy face. With the dawn of redeeming grace. Jesus, Lord at thy birth. Jesus, Lord at thy birth. While the Christmas truce of 1914 was temporary, Isaiah's prophecy reminds us of a peace that is eternal, a peace that is secured by the Prince who reigns. And while this peace will ultimately be realized at Christ's second coming, believers in Christ can experience a foretaste of this peace now, a peace that affects our relationship with God, a peace that affects our relationship with one another, peace that affects our relationship with ourselves. In John 14, verse 27, Jesus said, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid." So regardless of what is going on in the world around us, we can have peace, knowing that perfect peace is just around the corner. The question for us is, are we living under the reign of the Prince of Peace? Have we submitted our lives to the righteous King who alone can bring true peace? And as his people, are we committed to proclaiming this peace to a world that so desperately needs it? A world that seems devoid of peace. This morning, if you are weary, you are burdened, if you are longing for peace, come to King Jesus, who invites all to find their rest in him. And as we continue in this Advent season, may we embody his peace in our relationships, pointing others to the Prince of Peace who reigns and will reign forever. May we trust him. May we walk in his peace. And may we live as citizens of his now and not yet kingdom. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word and for the promises you made long ago through the prophet Isaiah, who find their yes in Jesus. Lord, we are reminded this morning of the brokenness in our world and the deep longing in our hearts for true peace, true shalom. Help us to trust in Christ's rule and reign, even now, as we wait for the day when he will return to make all things new. By your Spirit, transform us to be people of peace in our homes, in our community, and in the world, reflecting the love and righteousness of our Savior. Fill our hearts with hope, our lives with peace, and our voices with praise for the one who reigns both now and forever. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.